little trailer for Ai Weiwei. You probably heard of him, right? The Chinese activist. He's a troublemaker guy. He's an artist. But I think it depicts with visuals of what activism is about. Mm.
因为我们养了好多狗和猫，养了40只猫中呢，有一只猫会开门。如果我没见过这只会开门的猫呢，那我就不知道猫还能够开门，它能跳起来把门把手。
There are particular moments which allow a voice to change the way that people think.
He's a Beijing Andy Warhol.
He wants to shock you. When you see him drop a Neolithic pot, he's saying, I love the culture, but I want something new.
I think the most important media of our time is Twitter.
They call him Ai Shen online, Ai God. That's a very dangerous description in China.
What inspired you to come up with this project?
5,000多学生，对不对？你一口否认这个，没有必要的。你得调查一下有没有豆腐渣工程。Is he really allowed
to say these things?
Are you worried?
Yes, I am worried.
If I don't push, it's not going to happen.
操你妈祖国！操你妈祖国！
It gets to him at the very end. No thinking. Don't do it.
娘了个逼的祖国！谁啊？
I
act brave because I know the danger is really there. If you don't act, the danger becomes stronger.
He's probably the only Chinese artist who really cares about this country, who put his life on the line for something that he believes in.
最有很奇特的经验过就会在你心中就会存在了，这个东西谁也拿不走。你好，你好，你好。That's Ai Weiwei. I didn't know about him about a year ago. I think I was just searching stuff on YouTube, and I'm like, wow, that's interesting. And I saw the documentary. It's pretty good. So I'm here, my name is Randy Jurado Ertll. I'm here to talk about the life of an activist in the front lines 24/7. It's my second book, and I decided to write it because there's a lot of stereotypes and myths relating to what activism is, or what defines or who is an activist, what are social movements. And I think it's important to keep this issue at the forefront, especially with the Occupy movement and many other movements that are well known or documented, like the civil rights movement. But there's others that are not that well known, even though we would think they would be. But the new generation, sometimes they don't know. They don't know what the Chicano movement was about. They don't know about the Black Panther movement. They don't know about the Brown Berets. They don't know about many grassroots movements, because a lot of times the mainstream media likes to focus, I would say, on safe issues or issues that don't question the power structure, just like what Ai Weiwei is doing in China, out of all places. So he does have a lot of courage, because there, just like here, you get imprisoned a lot of times when you speak up or question things, because there's only certain limits to what's allowed. But through writing, I feel that we can express ourselves and share our knowledge to empower others and to believe in themselves. And that's why I wrote my first book, Hope in Times of Darkness, A Salvadoran American Experience, and because there's not much literature about Central Americans. And then I decided to write this one, The Life of an Activist. A lot of times people think it's about me, but it's more about other people. I wanted to highlight and showcase different people. And Terrence Roberts was kind enough to write the foreword. He's one of the Little Rock Nine who desegregated Little Rock Central High School in 1957. Mm-hmm. And you've probably seen the iconic film footage, right? Which is pretty amazing. And we have to inform our current students, especially like in elementary school, middle school, high school, what that was about. Because I think that they are not aware, or they may take for granted the struggles of others. And I decided to dedicate my book to the original activist, Jesus Christ, because he was a revolutionary activist. And a lot of the things that we're fighting for, that's what he fought for, which is equity, fairness, justice, loving your neighbor, accepting others. Basic things that I think now people think are radical or revolutionary, and they're really not. But I think we've lost touch with a lot with reality. And I think Pope Francis is bringing up a lot of the issues too that many were scared to bring up. And he has a big megaphone, you know, because he's the Pope, but he's pretty much saying what activists have been saying for decades or generations. And I divided my book in evolution of an activist, and that angry and bitter is not necessarily the answer, because a lot of times we do go through that process, especially when we're younger. We go through the angry phase, which is, I think is very important and needed. And also, I talk about media as an advocacy tool, organizing press conferences, writing columns, raising money from foundations, government, grants, fundraisers. And I've profiled three well-known community nonprofits, Mexican American Legal Defense and Education Fund, MALDEF, and the Mexican American Opportunity Foundation, and El Centro de Acción Social in Pasadena that I used to head. I was the executive director there. And they're one of the three oldest Latino groups in California, if not the U.S., because MAOF was established in 1963, and MALDEF and El Centro were established in 1968. And I talk about how to organize fundraisers, how to organize and mobilize community members, how to deal with board of directors and bureaucracies. And I'm sure some of us are familiar with that, dealing with boards and bureaucracies. Concepts of community organizing and coalition building. And I talk about other well-known nonprofits too, and how to keep going. All you need is love and the purpose of being an activist. And I did talk about, I would say, issues that are like delicate. But I wanted to write them because we still have our First Amendment rights to some extent. And I think that we have to keep that intact. And we have to remind our government that the U.S. Constitution is sacred, you know, and that we know now after September 11th, of course, with Snowden, that everything gets recorded or analyzed. So you can't really do anything like before, where you could organize and mobilize a lot of people. In a spontaneous way or an impromptu kind of way. Now, it's already known before it's even organized. Mm-hmm. And that's why the Occupy movement didn't have much success, because it was infiltrated and it didn't continue. It has a little bit, but there's only ripple effects. And I talk about, I'm gonna read a couple of, two or three paragraphs, and I don't want to like bore you by talking too much. I'd rather have a conversation, a question and an answer. And I think that's more dynamic instead of me speaking.
Can I ask you to use the mic?
Okay, yeah, I'll use the mic.
Hello, hello.
Okay. It works. Okay. Okay, the report further states 61% of suspects in state of mind shootings turn out to be unarmed. What troubles us is that African American or Latino youth are more likely to be the suspect, to be the subject of a mistaken perception of dangerousness than is a white or Asian person. The report goes on to state that Latinos appear to be significantly overrepresented in shooting incidents in comparison to their overall arrest rates, while white suspects are underrepresented. Regardless of race or ethnicity, police-related beatings and shootings need to be investigated and monitored more closely. And let us not forget the July 5th, 2012 fatal beating of Kelly Thomas, a homeless, schizophrenic, by Fullerton police officers, Jay Ciccinelli and Manuel Ramos. And this is in the news because the case is in trial right now as we speak. Mm-hmm. And we must remind law enforcement officials to act in a way that creates safety and trust, not just in affluent areas, but also in poor and middle-class neighborhoods. What occurred in Fullerton was a tragedy and an injustice. But Kelly Thomas' case might have been ignored if he had not been the son of Ron Thomas, a retired Orange County Sheriff's deputy. Mm. Ron Thomas led a citywide effort to bring justice to his murdered son. He was persistent and not afraid, especially because he had countless supporters and knew how our legal system favors the more affluent. And I go on to talk about how wealthy individuals and powerful bureaucracies can hire high caliber criminal defense attorneys, while the poor usually get convicted and sentenced since they cannot afford seasoned, well-known, expensive lawyers. And I talk about ACLU, that we're fortunate that we have the American Civil Liberties Union and a few other organizations that do get involved in issues that most others don't care or dare to get involved in. And I talk about other issues that are also relevant in the book. And I think it's important to document what goes on in our communities, especially because there's not a lot of Latino or Latina well-known authors our books, I should include myself because I'm one, do not get really included in the curriculum of public schools or even universities, because a lot of times they want the same old safe books that have been adopted in states like Arizona, Texas, and California is very similar, because there is a certain level of censorship of which books get selected. It's usually the ones that we read when we were children, for us that are older, right? How are you? It's usually, you know, John Steinbeck, and that was one of my favorite authors because that's one of the few that I had access to, and of course I love his writing. And, you know, the others too that we always hear about, right? But they're not usually Latino or African American or even Asian. So I think that's why I started to write my books, so that our young people could have access to books that are not... that talk about what the community is going through. Mm-hmm. And Billy, he just walked in. I hadn't seen him in like over 20 years, right? Or more, 25? Yeah, because we went to middle school together, to Fauché. So we survived Fauché. Very few of us did. So that's why there's a few of us that are out there writing books, writing poetry, so that we could tell our story, because we did get, I would say, PTSD there to survive there every day. You know, the violence, it was every day. So I mean, how can you focus academically when you're just trying to survive and not get killed or beaten up on a daily basis? So it was no joke, and especially for us that had to walk and take the buses, the public buses, and we know that those areas were not safe and they're still not safe. So I wanted to document that in my first book and then my second book. But in my second book, I wanted to provide solutions and be constructive, and also not to come from a deficit perspective or a victim perspective, but more of an empowerment point of view, where we can take matters into our own hands to make a difference. Like Malcolm X said, you know, by any means necessary. And doesn't mean violence. I mean, it means legal tools, policy tools, electoral politics. So that's why I was trying to also break the stereotype of activists. Because what comes to mind when you hear about activists? What would you say describes an activist?
Radical.
Okay.
A threat?
Yeah, I mean, there's different definitions.
What did they say, a threat? Hear that a lot.
Yeah, a lot of times they're perceived as a threat because they're speaking up against injustices, and then that makes them seem as troublemakers when they're not. A lot of times they're just people who care about others and want to help other people, but they get labeled and targeted. And that happened to a lot of the people we look up to now. And William has heard me say this before about Malcolm X and Cesar Chavez and Martin Luther King. When they were alive, people hated them. Mm-hmm. And people, a lot of people didn't like Martin Luther King, even though he was just preaching nonviolence. They still hated him with a passion. That's why they killed him, of course. And Malcolm X, oh my God, he was seen as a devil because he was so outspoken. And Cesar Chavez, a lot of hatred towards him too. And a lot of these individuals was in their own movements. People were murdered, you know, in those organizations. Like even the United Farm Workers, some of the migrant workers were killed. And we know some of the cases of what's happened to different activists that we don't even know about. So I include some of those in my book, the ones that we don't really know about, because there are a lot. There's hundreds or thousands of activists in every community, and it's just that we don't hear about them. And I think it's important to document and to talk about what they had to go through to survive and to make it. Because a lot of times we hear about them when we learn about them when they're dead. And then that's what's sad about. And then we're like, oh, I wish I could have met him. Or I wish I could have learned more from him or her. So I'm trying to engage people so that we can start talking about people who are actually doing things in the community now, and to be supportive of them too, and for them not to be demonized or seen as troublemakers or people who like to burn things. And I mean, Weiwei, for those of you who came a little late, I showed the video of Weiwei, who's a Chinese artist, and he's an activist. And I wanted to showcase, you know, what he's had to go through, because I think it's admirable that he's had to face a lot of resistance in terms of being in prison, being beaten. They took away his building where he would make his art. Then the Chinese government accused him of evading paying taxes, and that's why they put him in jail. And a lot of other things they do to him, I mean, in terms of physical and mental torture. But he doesn't stay quiet, even though they tamed them a little bit. But through his art, he's able to express, I would say, issues that need to be brought up, like those 5,000 students that died at the university when the earthquake hit, because they did shoddy construction. The government didn't do it correctly. So he made a thing about art and showcasing, and then actually writing each name of every victim, even though the government did not want that to be known. And he does other kinds of things that are pretty important. And they've taken away his passport because they don't want him to travel, to come out of, like, leave China. So he really gets to speak through alternative media, like through Twitter and YouTube, even though, of course, they shut it down, but they're able to go around it somehow. And it's pretty, I would say, impressive, you know, that he hasn't given up. And he's not that different from what occurs to activists here in the U.S. too. That's what's interesting about it. We like to point out, you know, other injustices, other human rights violations, but we don't see what goes on here. And I think it's important to acknowledge what happens here at home too. And to let people know about it through writing, through discussions like this one. I think it's important. And to influence and motivate our students to get involved, because I think students are always at the forefront or at the vanguard of any social movement. They're the ones who actually make social movements successful. And they're the ones who a lot of times are organizing behind the scenes, you know, making the phone calls, talking to their friends, and that's where they learn a lot of their skills too, in terms of community organizing and being committed to social justice. So I'll stop with that. I don't want to talk too much, or too long, but you could. I would rather have a question and answer, because I think that would make it more interesting for you and for me, for everyone here. Because I think that the model of the classroom is starting to get old, right? People are saying that that's why our public education doesn't work, because it's true. Who wants to sit there like the whole day listening? I mean, I used to fall asleep in college when I had to listen to lectures for over an hour. I mean, no kidding. I was like, oh my God, this is too much. So I think that we need more innovative, interactive kind of teaching. And now I think through YouTube and social media, we're able to do that. You can teach science, math through the internet, and you can use that model from that gentleman who I think is pretty revolutionary, where he does the tutoring online and kids can figure out how to do any kind of math problem or science problem because they offer the solution. And I forgot the name of it. Have you seen it? They did a profile about it on 60 Minutes. But I think it's revolutionary about how kids are able to learn that way and actually grasp the concepts instead of just being talked down on. And I think that activism, it can be defined in many different ways. And I try to include people who are engineers, people who are full-time activists that are out there organizing marches, press conferences. So I try to go from this, you know, what the usual image is, to also the ones that we do not expect to be activists. Because sometimes they're activists in their own way. They could be leading a corporation, but they give some money to social causes. And there are a few that do that. And they're rare, but they're quietly doing it because they can't really let it be known, because otherwise they'll get fired probably. So do you have any questions related to my book? I know most here have not read it, but about the topic or about why I wrote the book or anything in general. Yes?
I haven't read your book. I plan on purchasing it. What are some of the things that you were involved in being an activist?
Yeah, you know, my trajectory, it's, I think it's unique, because with William, we talked about it, that my mom came here from El Salvador, and then I was born here in the early 70s, but then she got arrested by INS, because at that time, a lot of immigrants would work in downtown LA, of course, in the sweatshops, and that's where my mom worked, in the sewing industry, and she got arrested, and we got deported, even though I was born here, so I grew up in El Salvador. So I got to see what was going on in El Salvador in terms of the violence and the political movements there. And that was little, but I could process it, because a lot of the times we absorb the most from for wearing the wound to age five. And that's where when we learn how to how to talk and a lot of things. There's been even studies about that. And then when I came back, we moved to South Central out of all places, and we were one of the few Latino families there. And Mr. O'Brien, he was my teacher there for third and fourth grade. So, he's the one who taught me. At first I learned Spanish, right? Because it was bilingual education. And then I learned English afterwards. And it was really hard. It was really hard because of the immigrant experience. And I think that I went to high school in Rochester, Minnesota, because I went to a Better Chance program. So then I got to see the disparities. I got to see the reality, because Rochester was like heaven. There was no violence there, because the Mayo Clinic there is there, IBM, and all the kids are studious, because their dads or moms are doctors, engineers. So they're like mega nerds. All they do is study, because there's winters, you know, the snow. So it's a very academically focused kind of high school in the city. And I was like, wow. Then when I would come back, I would see the same stuff here, all the same violence. And I was like, nobody cares here. Nobody does anything to stop it. And it's true. Before 92, nobody did much about all the human rights abuses that were occurring in the inner city that I got to see. But I never read the articles until 1992, of a tragic event for people to pay attention. And then that's, at Oxy, that's when I became very aware, because that's where I started to read books about, well, I went to Occidental, about different movements. And that's how I evolved, I would say, to become a student activist. Yeah. So that's the Cliff Notes version, or brief answer. But it's been, it hasn't been a straight line. It's been ups and downs, a lot of challenges just to be here. Mm-hmm. Yes?
So what made you choose the writing as a tool as far as being an activist? What, you know, that particular tool in itself.
Yeah, you know, okay, this is a good question. Because like they say, it takes you back, right? It takes you, or life is a circle. And I think when we were at Fauché, we had that essay contest. I don't know if you remember, but I think Arco sponsored this. And then I wrote an essay about George Washington Carver, and I did write a column about it. And then I won that essay contest, but I thought I wouldn't win because I was competing with people like Charka, Lorna, yeah. You know, the smartest kids,
smart
right?
Kids.
Yeah. So I was like blown away when I won first place. So then I said, wow, if I can win by writing this, then I could do other things through writing. So then I started to write a little bit here and there. And I just kept writing a little bit here and there. And then I think when I got my first job out of college, I started writing columns for Opinión newspaper and other newspapers. So then it became a real passion and a real hobby. And then it evolved to writing books. So it's been gradual. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I was wondering, I've read the book, of course, Life of an Activist. I love the way it's both philosophical and practical and realistic, and the pros and cons of being, you know, an activist. Would there be any chance, you know, that that could be used as a text for university or even high school? Because to me, it really, it's realistic, and it really shows the pros and cons, the dangers, the rewards of being a, you know, an activist.
Yeah, you know, my first book, they do use it at some schools already, some universities. The second one, it's gonna take a little more work because the professors have to adopt it in their curriculum or their syllabus. And then also, K through 12 is very difficult because, like I mentioned, it really is this obscure committee of individuals who are usually white males who determine what books are going to be read by everyone in California. So then a lot of times they don't like to include books that talk about history, certain history that took place. And that's why we had the whole process of banning certain books in Arizona and Texas. Because in a way, books are a way to open the windows of the mind or, and to empower people. So I think that in a way, they don't want people, like when I was going to school, I don't think at Fauché they would have wanted us to read, like Malcolm X, for example. Because it would have been like, man, why are we allowing this to, why do we get treated this way? And I think until we go to college, and very few of us who are Latino African Americans go to college. The percentages are dismal, even here at UCLA. So very few get access to the books that could inspire them. So it's a challenge, really. But I think that little by little, we can get one person at a time to read our books. Yes?
I know for me, it took one book. Was there one book that you read that really opened up your eyes and said, okay, this is what I want to do with my life? Was there one thing that you read or one particular author that you read that really turned the light on for you?
You know, yeah, I think there were various ones. I haven't been able to pinpoint one. I'm sure there was one, but I think I used to read a lot, even when I was younger. But in college, I started reading James Baldwin and also Oscar Zeta Acosta, who wrote The Revolt of the Cockroach People. And those books started to influence me because I was like, wow, they're talking about real issues that happen every day. They're not talking about fantasy or made up stuff that's not reality, you know. So in a way, I was like, wow. So they always stayed with me. And there's a lot of what you discover in literature that after a while, there's a lot of connections. Sometimes history merges, and then even people, they're like, did I know that person? Yeah, because I read, like, for example, Ernesto Galarza. He went to Oxy. He was one of the first few Mexican Americans who obtained his PhD, I think, from Stanford or Columbia. I talk about him in my book. Mm. And he wrote books in the 1930s, 40s, 50s. Mm. And they were academic about the migrant struggle. And his research is what set the groundwork for the United Farm Workers and for Cesar Chavez to have data and accurate information about how migrants and farm workers were being exploited and how pesticides were being used in the fields and people were getting cancer and their children were getting deformities. And so I read it and I was like, wow, he wrote this book like 60, 70 years ago and it's relevant now. Mm-hmm. And he talks about the immigrant experience and about, he describes how his mom passed away because they were so poor that they couldn't afford medical care.
What's his name?
Oh, Ernesto Galarza. Ernesto. Yeah, he's a pretty innovative pioneer. Uh-huh. And they at Oxy, we have a room named after him, and at Stanford, too, they have one in his honor. I think that's because he went to school there. Mm. Otherwise, people don't know. Don't know about people like him. Mm-hmm. Any other comments? From what major are you here at UCLA?
Me? English.
English? Okay, wow. Cool. Yeah, that's an important major. I mean, that's how we get influenced to start writing, because I do talk about that about my English professors. I mean, I talk about Mr. O'Brien in my first book, how he helped me, but I talk about my professor at Oxy who helped me too, because I didn't really think at first that I was a good writer, so I had to gradually start believing in myself, because it takes a lot of effort. Yes?
Did you ever attend any kind of writer's workshops, or as far as when you were writing your manuscript, did you get any help with it, or did it just kind of flow out of you?
Yeah, I kind of did it the guerrilla grassroots way, where I just wrote it. But I had laid the groundwork. I had planted the seeds. Because before, when I used to work for the environmental movement, I used to take classes here, UCLA extension classes, on writing or different things. Because I always loved academia. So I felt that would help me. That would help me. So yeah, in a way I did. And then I actually went to conferences where they talked about books and writing. Not the usual ones that we hear of, no. More like the LA Times Festival of Books, that one, to hear the authors and the editors, and to get that perspective.
Was it hard finding a publisher to publish a book like that?
Yeah, it really is. It's a challenge. That's one thing you're always going to hear from writers, that a lot of times publishers, bottom line, they look for profit. It's a commercial venture, so they see what's going to sell, and that's what they promote, like Twilight, Harry Potter, Hunger Games, that are like blockbusters. And that's where they invest their money in terms of the marketing. They put millions of dollars in the publicity and marketing. That's why they're successful. And they swamp all the bookstores with their books and they put them in the front, you know, the best placement. There's a strategy to it. Because I've read books about that too, about the inside workings of the publishing industry and how it's dominated by like five monopolies, five different publishers. And I had to go with an academic publisher and I decided to go with them. They're in Maryland, but they distribute worldwide. Yeah. So, but it hasn't been easy, because you always have to keep pushing your books. Because young people are more interested in Twilight. They are, because you know it's very appealing.
Yeah, I have kids. And
right.
That's what they read.
Yeah, or whatever the latest trend is, like Diaries of a Wimpy Kid, for example. Which are, you know, good books, but I think as they evolve a little older, like high school or college, then they can start reading our books that will help. Even though kids who read my first book, even though they're in elementary school or middle school, it impacts them. Because I see them sometimes. I see the students and they tell me. They're like, oh yeah, oh, wow, your book really, like, helped me, and I really liked it. I'm like, wow, great. Mm-hmm. You know, and yeah. So it's like, it's really nice to see that, to see how a book can impact someone's life. Yes, and then I'll go with them. Yes.
Do you believe that's that's going to be a generational change that ignites pushing out, you know, the Western canon of these white writers that we read and these, you know, Steinbeck and things like this? Do you think that's just going to be a generational change that makes that creates that change? Or do you believe that's going to be something, you know, something else until we start reading more activist works in high school of, you know, more of, you know, Asian writers, Hispanic writers, etc.
Yeah, it is like a generational thing, and demographics are shifting, and then demographics are getting so large in terms of like minorities, where eventually they won't be the minority, you know, they'll be the majority, and soon, I mean, we're just like a year or so away from that in LA County for Latinos to become the majority. So then it's going to throw us off because we're gonna be like, oh, yeah, we're not a minority anymore. We're over 50%. And I think we need to start thinking that way and also be, I would say, responsible to not do what others have done to us, not to be exclusive. Because that can happen because there's that phrase by that. I read the book. It's interesting. I read this book at Occidental College by and the publisher is the same publisher I have now, University Press of America. And then that was one of my favorite books on comparative politics, and it talked about the whole theory about power and politics and how the oppressed become the oppressors, mm-hmm. and that can happen a lot of times. So then we have to be responsible so that, because I think we have to embrace all literature. It doesn't matter if it's white, Asian, Black, Latino, Middle Eastern. I think it's important to embrace all. And in our case, we've been excluded. That's been the problem. So hopefully we won't do that too. You know, when we, let's say our future students here become PhD and doctors, right, and professors, and then you get to select your books, you'll be conscious of. I'm including good books that will give a round perspective, a balanced perspective.
And also when you start reading, even if you like when I first started reading, I was reading mostly Black studies. But after a while, you start looking in the footnotes, and they've got their research from somebody else, and that's mm-hmm. a person from another culture. So it all kind of intertwines eventually anyway as you expand your reading.
Yeah, no, and there are. I read some Asian literature books from some authors, and I've learned a lot. Like at Oxy, I read Farewell to Manzanar. That's where I learned about that. I've read recently, I can't remember, but from this Middle Eastern author. It's an obscure book, but it's awesome. It's wonderful. It's much better than Three Cups of Tea, which we know turned out to be somewhat of a fraud, right? Because the author made up a lot of things. He said he got kidnapped by the Taliban just to make it more exciting. And I think sometimes that's not very professional or ethical in the literature world, because you have to stay true to your art. You can't make up stuff just to try to sell. But he duped a lot of people.
Yeah.
He duped General Petraeus, he duped the Pentagon. And sometimes these books or literature can have such an impact that even national security policy could be written or implemented based on lies. Mm-hmm. So we have to be responsible, and we have to use a higher level of scrutiny when we write or read, because we can't just take books or just be. We have to question them, and I think that's what it's about. Mm-hmm. That's what activism is about, actually, questioning power, questioning literature, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that. Bureaucracies don't like to get questioned because a lot of times it creates a mismatch. And you could tell by how the bureaucracy structure, their seating arrangements is always in terms of higher level of seating, and then also people have to follow all this bureaucratic process to speak, if they're allowed to speak at all. And there's techniques too to censor people. Like about real social justice issues usually don't come up. Well, they'll put them at the end of the agenda until midnight when everybody's gone.
Yeah.
Very few activists stay at those city council, school board meetings, you know, that go till midnight. And that's a lot of times where certain decisions are made that people are not even aware of. And then also, activists a lot of times don't have the resources, you know, in terms of having attorneys. So then that's why I talk about nonprofits have a big responsibility in our society to play that role, to represent the poor. Oh yeah, William.
No, that's in reading your book, of course, I that's what I found intriguing was that you're an extremely unselfish individual. And what I mean is that, you know, we live in a me world. Mm-hmm. Like everybody's I. And, you know, so like these nonprofits, for profits, that's what I call them, it's all about them. It's all about, you know, just collecting funds, displaying a dog and pony show, and just moving on with their agenda to continue just collecting funds. So I found it intriguing that you shared in your book, you know, all the different processes, the pros and the cons of running nonprofits. And so, yeah, I wanted to commend you and then you say thank you for putting out such a masterpiece. So I'm grateful for that, man.
Well, thank you. Yeah, they probably don't like it. Some of the nonprofits. I was nice to them, actually. You know, I didn't expose a lot of things because sometimes they're our allies in a way. But we also have to hold them accountable. But I think that that's the role of journalism, of the LA Times and New York Times to do that. They have the resources to look at certain things that have to do with fraud or corruption. And I think it's important to hold them accountable too in terms of, and I talk about some of those in my book, yeah. Some organizations that have been investigated because they haven't done the correct thing. Mm-hmm. And I think you have, there's always like I talk about realities and that any movement or activist or leader is not perfect, and a lot of times that's what we strive for, that's what we look for. We look for this like ideal pious kind of person, and what I'm trying to convey is that that's not possible, that's not reality, because that's what we want, but that's like too much, and then we put too much pressure on those leaders, you know, like we know. And then when they have a scandal that comes out, like a Achilles heel, oh my god, everyone is so disappointed, you know, when they have affairs. Mm-hmm. And then I'm thinking, they're just human. Mm-hmm. They're not a god or a saint. So I try to convey that message that we have to be a little more understanding, because even Ai Weiwei, he's married, right? He has a wife, but he had a kid with this other lady. That's why you see that little kid like standing there in the sesame seeds. Mm-hmm. And they ask him about it in the documentary, and he's like, well, you know, it happened. Mm-hmm. And then I'm sure that gives him headaches a lot often, because he has to deal with that dynamic in his own personal life. And that happens a lot, because we've seen it with Jesse Jackson, we've seen it with many other civil rights and immigrant rights leaders. Mm-hmm. So it's not easy work, actually, because the expectations are very high. But then there's that great phrase, I don't remember what part of my book I have it, but like I forgot how it goes. I should have written it, but about what, you know, to those who are given much responsibility. Mm-hmm. Is, you know, falls on them, right? Or to those who have a lot and they have to be responsible, especially if they have a lot of power, because they should be cognizant of that. And I think a few were, and that's why they were able to evolve to become very iconic. Because I've talked to a lot of people about people who actually knew some of the classic individuals like Cesar Chavez, people who, I talked to people who actually worked for him, talked to his secretary, talked to Dolores Huerta, I talked to a lot of people about him because I wanted to know more about him as a person. And he was pretty good. he avoided a lot of temptations. I'm sure he had weaknesses that we still don't know to this day because he was not perfect. But he was very committed. I think that was the key. He was like extraordinarily committed. That's what distinguished him. And I'm mentioning him because we're in the Chicano mm-hmm. Research Center. And he would fast for 35 days, and that's rare. That's almost unheard of. Only I think Gandhi was the one who would go that long. Because today, Eliseo Medina from the SEIU, he was doing the fasting with the other immigrant rights activists, and he, along with the others, lasted like 22 days, 23. They quit today, a few of them, because they couldn't handle it anymore. And I understand, because that's what happened to Cesar Chavez. He injured his internal organs, so they sacrifice. Some of them sacrifice their mind, spirit, and physical well-being. And some, like Malcolm X, they choose to give their life because they know they're gonna get eventually murdered. And sometimes they're just counting down the days, just like Monsignor Romero from El Salvador. He had been threatened so many times by the death squads that he knew that sooner or later they were gonna kill him, because they offered him security, right? Like bodyguards and a bulletproof vest. This is late 70s. And he was no, he was like, no, I don't need that. You know, because, and then he like knew, you know? So there was some sorrow to it. It was not like he was like looking forward to it, but I've seen some of his documentaries, like when they interviewed him. He was a very calm person, very serene. He was just like Pope Francis. He was just like that. But at that time, the conservative Catholic Church ran everything, so they turned their back on him. Because he went to the Vatican to ask for their support, and they said, forget it, you know, you're a radical communist priest, archbishop, so too bad. So then, and I talk about him in my first book, and I mentioned him in my second book, because I think he's a person that we can learn a lot from. Mm-hmm. Yep. And yeah, and it's sad, you know, like how they killed him. Yep. It was interesting that he almost baptized me, really, because my mom knew him. So, yeah, so. But he became a martyr, too, because he for poor people. Yep. He was good. He was very kind. I mean, no kidding. He was really kind, I mean, from work. Like just talking to people, oh man, he was like really like decent, you know, person overall. He wasn't political, he wasn't like into leftist or right wing stuff. He was just fighting for the poor, for people not to get killed. I'm sorry,
I was gonna say, did he write anything? Did he leave any notes or memoirs or anything?
You know, he did write. He would record a lot. He left a lot of recordings for his sermons because he was really into that. Because he had a radio show that was broadcast nationally every week on live radio. So he had a lot of power with that. That's why he had millions of people that would tune in to his radio show. No kidding. And then you could hear it everywhere because it was, it would magnify since millions of people had it on, you could listen to the radios if you were walking on the, you could listen to his sermons while you were walking on the street because it was so loud. And then that's why he became a threat.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever been?
I'm sorry?
Have you ever threatened you?
You know, in different ways. I mean, sometimes we don't talk about that. We just have to be very like brave and courageous in what we do. Mm-hmm. And then we know in our heart we're not doing anything wrong. And what we're just trying to do is bring awareness and consciousness. And yeah, sometimes people get upset, especially if you expose certain things. And I talk about different things in the book too.
I like the way in your first book it almost opens with the fact that I experienced two civil wars, one in El Salvador and then one in South LA. And I was wondering what, you know, inside you allowed you to transcend all that negativity to be who you are today. I know that's not a one sentence answer, but I mean, is there any idea that you have that, to communicate, and especially to other young people?
You know, I think it's a hard question to answer, because it's very complex. It deals with a lot of thought and a lot of emotions. But I think that it's all the kids, you know, that I remember and that I saw and that are no longer with us. They got killed, they were murdered, you know, when they were at Menlo, and then Fauché. Right. We knew a lot of those kids. And then Manual Arts. If you add them, it's a lot. So I knew dozens that were murdered or killed. And I think that I was always like, it never made sense to me. Why were all these kids getting killed? Or they were killing each other? So I think their spirits always speak to me somehow. They do. Yeah, they like, they always come back to me. They, all of their faces. Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, wow, why did they have to die? If people would have done something for them, they probably wouldn't have had to been murdered. And they were killing each other, and then the police was also killing them. So it's like very repressive. And it's a very violent kind of scenario, because there's a lot of violence within the homes. I talk about that in my first book, in the home, in the school, in the community. So there's violence everywhere. Mm-hmm. So it's like, so I've always been trying to work towards finding ways to prevent or avoid violence, because it just creates so much pain and chaos. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, so then if there's no other questions, I mean, I'll be glad to sign my book if you're interested in getting one. And then I have my first book and my second book. So are there any like final thoughts or questions or comments? Should we introduce ourselves? Like, or I'm sorry, go ahead.
If you had to sum up for individuals to be steadfast and encouraging them to be an activist in whatever it is, what would you say to them in a few words?
Like to continue?
Yeah. Because sometimes to continue on in a cause, sometimes, you know, people get really discouraged for monumental things that they have to go through. But it's worth it at the end. What would you, you know, encourage somebody to, if you just have to say some keywords or just, you know.
Yeah, you know, it's true. You have to find inspiration, like, from others or from within yourself. And you have to go the spiritual route sometimes. You know, you have to find religion or some spirituality kind of thing, just to believe in something. Because, like, for me, I've seen so much corruption and so much deception and so many different injustices that, yeah, you start to get discouraged because the odds are so huge and monumental, and that you have to find like inspiration within somehow. Like, even if you read things that are, I would say, motivational and little things, sometimes words do make a difference. What people tell us, what they say, or what they write. And then sometimes that's all it takes for somebody to encourage us. And it makes a difference, because sometimes we do look up to people, and they say something like for example, don't give up, or just continue. Even though sometimes they sound like cliches, but they're not, depending on who says them. Because it's true, that's all it takes. Because sometimes, believe me, I felt like giving up, And I have in different ways, because it depends how you define failure. They're not failures if you give up on something. It just means you choose a different path. Because a lot of people question also decisions we make. And sometimes it's hard to explain them, because imagine trying to explain to people, like a career change, for example. Sometimes people get used to us playing a certain role, and then if you decide to change or to leave a good job, people always question it. Why did you leave a good job? But then if you're happier, it's better. Because sometimes our jobs can be draining, and they can slowly kill us, and they can kill our spirit too. So we gotta find that calling, and it's hard. It's really hard, but I think that we could get that through through writing ourselves or through reading. Like right now, I have like all these books that I have to read myself, and I always try to find that one book that's gonna continue to inspire me. And right now, I have George Orwell's 1984 that I'm gonna read. I'm gonna read Travels with Charlie that I haven't read, with John Steinbeck. So I have to catch up with some of the classics. But I feel that even those books will teach me something. Because I read some awkward books that kid, like a Latino kid from the inner city, from South Central, wouldn't read, you know, that, because I found them. I don't know how I found them, but I found this book by Russell Baker, Growing Up. And he's a white author, and I read it, and then I thought it was great. It's have you heard of it? It's a classic. It's really good. Talked about his life, about growing up in the Great Depression, and also being a paper boy. And I was like, oh, I was a paper boy too. So sometimes we find certain books that speak to us. So that's the long answer.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, I get inspired by Billy's poetry.
Well, that's great.
Because I think poetry is wonderful. And William does poetry too. Oh yeah, you're gonna do a poem for us?
Okay, cool.
Okay, and then we'll conclude with that, and then I'll sign my book.
Thank you. William.
Thank you very much for coming.
Man, thank you for being so kind, Randy. I really appreciate all your work. I'm very humbled and grateful for the day that we met. I believe that we need more people like Randy Jurado. Poor people, voiceless people, the other, the different folk always need somebody on their side creating inharmonious sounds. And so I'll share something real quick with you guys. To answer my boys with the Bruins hat there, beat up on my USC. But yeah, that was a good beating. I'll give y'all credit for that. Creating your own path, writing your stories, like Randy said, you just don't know how they can affect somebody else. I believe also that art can save a lot of lives in the future. And writing them engraves them into American and worldwide history. And to give just a quick example of something is, I came up with the concept of black bubblegum, and the publishing company tells me, oh, we're gonna create some art and we're gonna draw these things. And I said, I think what we'll do for this round, I said, is we'll go ahead and use a real picture from a street in the city of Los Angeles as my art. And so this is an actual real picture. It's black bubblegum spit on the concrete that has been like just abandoned. This is a real picture. For stuff like this, gum to be spit on the concrete and not clean, it's pretty unbelievable. I always used to wonder, I used to dip in and out of the liquor stores. I'm going to give you more of the inside stuff here. And I used to dip in and out of the liquor stores. Now I used the word dip on purpose. There was so much violence and so much crime going on in front of the liquor store. And I always used to look at the black bubble gum, and I always used to wonder, man, if that black bubble gum could speak, I wonder what it would say, you know? And so I was going to share another piece. but I'm gonna go ahead and just do black bubblegum. I was gonna do something else, but I'll do black bubblegum. And you know what? I'll throw a little picture in there. I won't take too much time out, Randy. I actually wrote a quick little piece, and I actually had my girlfriend Evie, which is here, she actually did the art on this, and I actually laid it out for you guys. So it's a quick piece, and so I'll share it with you guys. And this is just to show that creating art can save life through writing. It doesn't matter where you come from. And I represent the Westlake District, Pico Union, an abandoned transient zone. I lived in South Central. In the 90s, I lived in the Nickerson Gardens. And when the riots took place, I was in the mix of them. And I'll share that with you, because a lot of people say, oh, you know, I've heard about the riots. I was inside of the places trying to get something because I was dead broken. It was everybody doing it, so I was doing it. Black bubblegum. As you stand outside the entrance of most ghetto liquor stores, if you were to look down toward the ground, you would be able to see old pieces of dried up black bubblegum stuck to the concrete sidewalk. If these pieces of gum could speak, they would be able to share some unbelievable horror stories with you. One of these stories would paint a picture of a time when blood/brains splatter on them, while another victim of ghetto violence would get shot in their presence. If this gum could speak, it would be able to repeat the final words the boy who got his brains blown out was saying at the very moment a bullet penetrated his skull. Interesting enough, a piece of gum was spit on the concrete sidewalk by the killer a couple of days before the murder took place. To add fuel to the devil's fire, the boy who lost his life had also spit a piece of bubblegum on the very same concrete sidewalk himself. After months of people stepping on both of these pieces of gum, the sun's rays hit the gum, connecting a heat splice that melts these two pieces of black bubblegum into the pores of a concrete sidewalk, creating a sticky connection between the killer and the victim, black bubblegum. Thank you guys for your time, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you to William. I'm always impressed with his poetry. And so we'll conclude it. And then I'll sign my book. If you like, where should I sit? I guess right there, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So